Everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television. I'm your host, Boyd Pierce. Another outstanding card. A special challenge match headlines the card. 320 pounds, 6'9". The big cat, Ernie Ladd, takes on 454-pound one-man gang from the stable of General Skandar Akbar. All the top stars are here. Iron Mike Sharp, the Junkyard Dog, Bob Roop, the Assassin, the Grappler. You'll see them all, and you'll hear the expert description by our guest commentator, Cowboy Bill Watts. Bill?
Well, thank you, Boyd. It's always great to be here. And, you know, I think a lot of things start simmering along about now, looking toward that big summer Superdome, July the 17th. And one of the things that really shocked me is Ted DiBiase apparently has really had it deep in his craw about the March 17th, the way he lost the North American title. And I can certainly sympathize with him, but I think it just finally blew up today, and earlier he gave Grizzly Smith and Mid-South Sports an ultimatum, and we'll get into that a little bit later. But first, let's go to the ring to Iron Mike Sharp and Randy Bays, the first match.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 240 pounds from Fort Worth, Texas, Randy Bays. And in the blue corner at 287 pounds from Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, Iron Mike Sharp.
Introduction of the opening event in the orange trunks from Fort Worth, Texas, Randy Bays against the number one athlete from Canada, Big Iron Mike Sharp.
Well, I'll tell you, Randy Bays better be in a condition because Iron Mike certainly is. And if looks tell anything, Randy's not in near the fine condition, doesn't have the strength as Mike Sharp in the first collar to elbow tie-up, referee's position standing. Mike Sharp showed just why he's called Iron Mike. We'll be having an interview with Ted DiBiase. Like I say, he's really been upset about the fact that he lost the North American title. Not the fact that he lost it, because Ted's just too good a sportsman for that, but the fact that the way he lost it, and boy, you and I watched it and we had to agree with him, but Mid-South has long ago established that whatever happens here on television, that we will not be able to review the tapes to change the outcome, just as the National Football League doesn't, nor does the National Basketball Association or baseball or anybody else. You just can't do it. So however it goes down, it goes down. And it was a raw deal, and Ted feels that he hasn't gotten the return bout that he's entitled to, that can keep out outside interference and also not let Roop save the title by being disqualified. So these are some of the things we'll talk to Ted a little bit later. Also, a new ruling by Mid-South, Charlie Lay, and stating a lot of complaints. Naturally, the people that complain are not the people that have all the accolades, but there's been some complaints by some wrestlers about the fact that the Junkyard Dog and Mr. Olympia hold both the Louisiana State Heavyweight title, the Mississippi State Heavyweight title, and the Mid-South Tag title. And that brings up the situation that the North American Championship, if the Dog or Mr. Olympia would win that, they'd have all the titles on these two individuals. Well, Charlie Lay said that they can definitely hold individual titles and still wrestle as a tag team champions. However, if they would win, one of them would win the North American Championship, he would then have to forfeit his state championship to fulfill the obligations of the North American title. And you can certainly see why they couldn't undergo the strenuous scheduling of both the North American Championship and either the Louisiana or the Mississippi Championship. And I'm sure either one of those men, fine young champions that they are, would regret having to forfeit the state titles that mean so much to them. But they would certainly be moving up the ladder in the professional wrestling world by winning the North American title. But that's all conjecture at this point. And like I say, it all started by a bunch of guys hoping to win something by not beating anybody, I'm sure. And they would like to see I've seen a title taken away from him, but that's just not going to happen in Mid-South. Randy Bays trying to find a shortcut with Iron Mike Sharp, but the big strong man from Canada is no stranger to the rough and tumble. You know, Boyd, when you dish it out, you got to be ready to take it. And Randy Bays looked like he was dishing it out, but I don't think he's got too much stomach as when it comes to taking it. And Iron Mike is devastating. He's a tremendously conditioned athlete. He didn't quite get up on that drop kick, and Iron Mike caught just as much of the impact of his own drop kick by mistiming there as Randy Bays did. But you can see that Mike is in such better condition that he's right back to his feet. And he just picked this man up like you'd pick up a sack of grain at an old feed mill. And that's an uncomfortable position with his shoulder cramming in under the low ribs in the back. And there it is.
and he gives it up, and Iron Mike Sharp takes the victory over Randy Bays. We'll be back. Ted DiBiase in action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
Well, boy, there's an old saying that still water runs deep. And, of course, Ted DiBiase, you and I have watched his career from when he was Rookie of the Year, and he battled such guys as Killer Carl Cox, and, of course, Dick Murdoch kind of took him under his wing and helped train him. And so Ted DiBiase cut his teeth on the toughest ones in the business. His dad was a tremendous professional athlete, a great amateur athlete, who was fatally injured and died from an injury in the ring. So Ted knows that it's not going to be all picnics and easy living. It's tough and hard. When you see these guys here on television, it looks so great and so easy for them, but you got to realize the hours they put in the training, the traveling, they learn everything the hard way. Well, Ted, March the 17th, was defeated right here on television. He was supposed to wrestle Paul Orndorff for the North American title, but Orndorff's car apparently malfunctioned, or as we found out later, Bob Roop had a hand in it. But Orndorff, with Bob Roop, the man who designed the counter to the figure four, had also designed a plan to lift that North American title from Ted DiBiase, so that when Roop got Orndorff out of the picture, they executed the plan with General Skandar Akbar and the one-man gang, and Ted lost that title. Well, Ted's really been stewing, and he feels that Mid-South hasn't supported him. We've done all, as from the board meetings I've sat in on, and Grizzly Smith, everything's been done that can. Bob Roop was skillful at avoiding getting pinned down in the match, so it's certainly not all Mid-South's problem. But I understand an intense competitor like DiBiase and his desire, and it's all coming to a head. And today, DiBiase shocked the wrestling world with this announcement he made to Grizzly Smith. Let's listen to that now.
On March 17th of this year, I was robbed of the North American heavyweight title right here on TV by Bob Roop, Skandar Akbar, and the one-man gang. And I felt sure at that time that Mid-South Wrestling would not let that decision stand, but they did. And I feel like it was one of the biggest ripoffs that ever come down the pike. But I didn't cry over that. I didn't gripe about it. I accepted it. I bit the bitter pill and I went on, knowing that Mid-South Wrestling would stand behind me and give me ample opportunity to regain the North American title. Well, up until right now, I don't feel like that's been done either. And I'm serving notice right now here today to matchmaker Grizzly Smith that I've set a goal that within the next 2 weeks, right here on this television, I get a North American title shot with a no disqualification clause. If I don't get the shot, I'm going to leave Mid-South. If I get the shot and I don't win the title, I will also leave Mid-South for good.
Well, boy, there you have it from an intense young man, Ted DiBiase, and you're getting his feelings right from the heart. I don't think Ted is trying to be flippant about it, and he's certainly not trying to be overbearing. What it is he's letting Mid-South know just how deeply he feels about it, and so he's given them an ultimatum that he's set a schedule that he wants within 2 weeks a no disqualification match for that North American title. He'd like to do it right here on television where the whole country can witness it, and he hopes to cut the outside interference. But he's also said that if you give me that match and I can't beat the guy fair and square, then I'll leave. I'll pack my bag and go. And I think that statement is almost an exclamation point. And I know Grizzly Smith is certainly considering that. We'll find out more about it later in the show today. Let's go to the ring now and Reese Bowden.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 245 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond. And in the blue corner at 255 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, former North American heavyweight champion Ted DiBiase.
With Mike Bond now in the black tights, and there you see Ted DiBiase shedding his colorful blue jacket. Action underway. Rick Ferreira, the referee.
Well, Ted DiBiase, a great young athlete, Boyd. Grew up in a wrestling family. Played football at West Texas State. Waist locking the man, body locking him right to the canvas. When you're on top and controlling him, it's hard for him to get any offense going. And Ted DiBiase not waiting for the break. As soon as they break, he's on him. He's super aggressive. I think Ted has reached that point in his career where he says he's going to make it happen. Fireman's carry right in on Mike Bond. Mike Bond, a good athlete. Ted's pushing in there. That old running mate of Ted DiBiase, Dick Murdoch, on that great tour. Hong Kong, Japan, Dubai. And Ted DiBiase right here getting ready to put Mike Bond on tour, it looks like. Hip lock. Firing away. Like I say, he's really intense. And it's come to a point, you know, the pressure gets on these kids when they're out there. And the prestige and the power and the position of that North American title and Ted's tasted it. And I say this, Ted's had a stormy career with it, but he's never, nobody's ever beat him fair and square. Nobody's ever gone out and just said, Ted DiBiase, I'm going to beat you and beat you. He's been the one that's been the aggressor, and he's been a great champion. And you and I both, our sympathy are with him as far as the way he lost that title. And I hope that Grizzly Smith and Charlie Lay will sanction that match. And I'd love for the fans at home to get to have that match right here on TV with the North American champion, Bob Roop. One fall, no disqualification. Power slam!
Ted DiBiase, a determined young man, takes the victory. We'll be back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
My boy Pierce, Grizzly Smith, had asked Bob Roop his opinion of Ted DiBiase's ultimatum. And we'll join Bob Roop and Reese Bowden in the ring for this next match. But first, let's hear the brief comments Bob Roop made and then directly to the ring.
Ted DiBiase, pack your bags. Grizzly Smith told me you gave him a two-week ultimatum. You either wrestle me, win the belt, or whatever, you're going to leave. You want a no-DQ match? Well, listen, to get rid of you, I would beat up my own mother. And all I have to do is beat you again. Remember, I'm the one that put you out for 6 weeks. I'll beat you anywhere, anyway. I'm the man with the plan. I'm the one. Give me the rules. I'll figure out a way to beat you. Pack your bags, DiBiase.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 252 pounds from Blacksburg, Virginia, the North American heavyweight champion, Bob Roop. And in the blue corner, at 227 pounds from Ardmore, Oklahoma, Mike Hudspeth.
Bob Roop, dressed in red, white, and blue, proudly displaying his North American heavyweight title. A coveted belt around his waist, even though this is a non-title match. His opponent, Mike Hudspeth, and Alfred Neely, the referee, Bill.
Good duck under into a waist lock, sagging down, and Hudspeth trying to move with Roop, but Roop countering. He's got a great amateur background. Bob Roop, who seems to create a lot of controversy, the man with a plan, and he certainly always has a plan. Seems like every time he's backs against the wall, he can figure some way, with a lot of help from a lot of other nefarious individuals, to pull it out. And of course, we saw Ted DiBiase and his opinion and Bob Roop's answer to that. You know, Boyd Pierce, there could be another answer to that. The Junkyard Dog, after what happened here last week on television when he wrestled Bob Roop for the North American title, the Junkyard Dog has been seething, and he's known to make a lot of things happen. He's the man of the hour, and I'll guarantee you when they start trying to put him out of the wrestling business by injuring his leg, he's going to go after the man that designed it. And the one way they eliminate Roop is to take that North American title. So it could be a foot race between DiBiase and the Dog as to who gets to take Roop apart first. Bob Roop.
No doubt that Bob Roop is a wanted man, and heavy hangs that crown on top of his head.
As you see here, he's all confidence and all ability. Of course, Bob Roop's been making some snide remarks about Steve Dr. Death Williams, a young four-time All-American wrestler from Oklahoma University, and he'll be on the Barry Switzer's Oklahoma University football team next year as the Doc is making his professional rookie season in wrestling. And Bob would like to grab Doc early, but I think with the ability Doc's got, he might bite off more than he can chew too. But Roop just tries to keep everybody after him and keeps himself right in the center of activity, and he's doing it right now. One, two, three.
Bob Roop, North American heavyweight champion, takes the victory. We'll be back after this important message from Mid-South Wrestling.
I'm sure that every opponent that has to face the Junkyard Dog would like to be able to figure some way of sidetracking the Dog or getting some help. And of course, the man with the plan, Bob Roop, was defending his North American title last week against the Junkyard Dog. And on March the 17th, he had injured Ted DiBiase, put him out of wrestling for 6 weeks, and in some people's eyes, had stolen the North American title. And he thought if a game plan worked once, let's try it again, and let's rejoin the final moments of that match as the one-man gang appeared again. But something else happened. Another man, 6'9", 320, Ernie Ladd, had a score to settle. And the Junkyard Dog has a lot of friends on his side, too. Let's watch this. The Dog firing back. Side suplex shows the Dog has advanced constantly as he studies the sport that he loves so much. He's a great family man, and the guy loves the sport, the business, the way to make his family the money, and support him in the style, like he said, that he never had as a kid. And here he goes. The one-man gang, Boyd Pierce.
It is the one-man gang. It's a ring.
He's trying to do like he did to DiBiase. He's going to try to get the Dog's leg, and the one-man gang just threw Alfred Neely out here. You can hear him thump clear across, and he's got
the Junkyard Dog, and he's trying, Neely's calling for the bell, Boyd Pierce, but they're trying to wipe out the Junkyard Dog. Rupe already has the title. He doesn't care about losing the match. Ernie Ladd just came with a chair. Ernie Ladd just came with a chair, and he's after the one-man gang. But Bob Roop is pulling the dog in. The dog, we don't know how bad that knee is. He has that bad knee from football. We don't know if the gang got him. Skandar Akbar on the scene, and Ladd's going after Akbar. The one-man gang was really hammered. The shoulder breaker by Bob Roop. Still, Bob Roop has a title. He doesn't care about the disqualification. He's trying to eliminate an opponent. DiBiase. DiBiase sacrificed himself. DiBiase sacrificed himself to save the dog. What a love, what a feeling between these great athletes that have a common enemy. Roop going for the high knee of the dog. The dog is howling. Boyd Pierce, the dog is unleashed. He's unleashed a fury. The back in the alley in the ghetto, like
the
he said, fighting for his life.
Fuming.
And he's trying to take, he's going to take Bob Roop. He's strangling him out there. The assassin and the grappler, the referee trying to hold back the dog. They're trying to pull, tug, pry Bob Roop away from the grasp of the Junkyard Dog. The Junkyard Dog is incensed. DiBiase, pandemonium, Boyd Pierce.
He is furious.
Believe you me, Ernie Ladd and Ted DiBiase have been victims. They've been there. Thank goodness for that, for the Junkyard Dog. But now you understand what DiBiase is so upset. But also the Junkyard Dog is upset because he realizes it's now a battle for survival. And I questioned the Junkyard Dog earlier about what his plans were concerning the title, plus some other statements he made. Let's go to that interview, and then we'll go direct to the ring to watch the fabulous one, the Junkyard Dog, in action.
Well, JYD, at Mid-South, the North American title has either been a blessing or a curse to many people, depending on how you look at it. And we've seen the power and the prestige and the income earned off of it either corrupt a lot of people or bring a lot of people to the heights of their ability. I've never thought that a title as such was what motivated you. You seem to be around me and everybody else. It seems that your family's first, that you do love this business, and that you always go out and give 100% for the people and for yourself. But after what happened last week with Bob Roop, when they had the one-man gang come in and try to do to you what they did to DiBiase and possibly re-injure your bad leg and put you out of wrestling, knowing you that a good defense is a great offense, how do you feel about the North American title situation?
Well, Bill, you know, I'm a very slow and methodical type person. I fought for everything I ever had. And that's for the incident that happened on television last week with the one-man gang and Roop. I've never been the type of person to chase anything. I always waited for the opportunity to knock at my door. But now, Bob Roop, I'm knocking, and I'm going to come in.
Well, I think that serves warning to Bob Roop, and I think that's the way you got to get rid of them, is take their titles and their prestige away from them. But you also heard Ted DiBiase, and the title thing is really getting to him because of the way it was taken from him. Certainly, I can sympathize with him, as can you. What do you think about his statement?
Well, you know, I've never been the type of person that box myself in, and I feel very bad because DiBiase is boxing himself in. He's a family man, and, you know, he's one of the very personal friends I have, but I think he's going about it the wrong way by boxing himself in a situation like that.
Well, only time will tell on that. Another thing, Junkyard Dog, that Charlie Lay and the Board of Directors of Mid-South have passed a ruling. It's seemingly enforcing division of titles because you hold one half of the Mid-South tag title, you also hold the Louisiana title, and your partner, Mr. Olympia, holds the Mississippi title. And they stated that the North American title is a regional title and can't be tied to one state, as is the tag titles. And if somebody, either you or Mr. Olympia, should win the North American title, you would have to vacate your state title, although you would still be able to compete as tag team champions. How do you feel about that ruling?
Well, I know the Louisiana title means a lot to me. The people here in Louisiana have been very, very lenient to was me, and they helped me a whole lot. But if I get the opportunity to wrestle Bob Roop for the North America, then if I get the opportunity to win the North America, I still would like to represent the people throughout the world, because that North America title will take you all over the world, and I would cherish and honor that North America just as much as I do the Louisiana. And I actually hate to have to vacate the Louisiana title, because they represent the people here in Louisiana, the state of Mississippi. But then again, if I am fortunate enough to win that North America title, if I get the opportunity, then I can represent the people here in Louisiana all over the world.
Well, thank you, JYD. And, of course, that's conjecture at this time. But when you're talking to Junkyard Dog, it seems like whatever he sets his goals, he's able to accomplish it. We'll just have to see as time goes by.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 235 pounds, from Charlotte, North Carolina, Billy, the Star Child Star.
Shut up over there!
And at 265 pounds from Tennessee, the Louisiana heavyweight champion and also holder of the Mid-South Tag Team belt, the Junkyard Dog.
Billy Starr in the ring. The music brings on the big thump, the Junkyard Dog, the referee, Rick Pereira, and that brings on the outstanding voice of Cowboy Bill Watts.
Well, thank you, Boyd Pierce. It's always exciting to see this man. He's setting the wrestling world on fire today. Every big main event, every super spectacular in the country, they want the Junkyard Dog to headline it. Houston, Texas just recently, another big record. He'll definitely be a headliner in the Superdome in New Orleans, July the 17th. And also in the beautiful Oklahoma City Myriad Center, July the 18th. Little Rock, Arkansas, July the 14th. This man is just in demand. Atlanta, the Omni, you name it, they all talk about the Dog, because when he comes in, the crowd gets to rocking, and they know one thing, it's going to be action. Because the Junkyard Dog says those four corners in there or his yard, his junkyard. And he said, nobody. And he means nobody's going to run him out of his yard. Powerful man. There'll be another big spectacular in Lake Charles, Sunday, July the 11th. Bench presses 560 pounds. He's got a temper, doesn't he, Boyd Pierce?
He certainly does.
He'll let fly, and Billy Starr is finding out just how much power he's got in those two big guns that he carries, and some people call them arms, but when they're that size, they're definitely, they could be bigger than some people's legs.
Just a tremendous athlete, Bill. We've saw not only the rise, you said earlier, of Ted DiBiase, but this man in the ring, the inimitable Junkyard Dog, we've seen him come from nowhere all the way to the top.
Well, that's right. He is a fantastic athlete. Ted DiBiase, without a doubt, he is a great athlete. It's always a pleasure here on Mid-South to see the caliber of competition we have. Big Ernie Ladd, the one-man gang, Bob Roop, and the Junkyard Dog is the middle of it all. Referee calling him on the break. Billy Starr, he's trying to figure any way except getting in there and facing the Dog. Billy Starr, when you start firing away, this man will definitely fight fire with fire. Came out of the ghetto. He's proud of it. Said he had to fight just to get his milk money to school. So he's no stranger to a beef. Billy Starr's finding out that he can't move that. There he goes with that big thump. He just put him about 6 feet under.
Big thump. And following that, one, two, three, and the hand raising of a victorious Junkyard Dog. We'll be back. The special challenge match, Big Ernie Ladd versus One Man Gang, after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
And now a special challenge match between two very big men. In the red corner at 454 pounds, General Skandor Akbar presents the One Man Gang. And in the blue corner, at 327 pounds from Houston, Texas, the big cat, Ernie Ladd.
Ernie Ladd, 6 foot 9 inch, 320 pound in the purple tights against the black clad, 454 pound one man gang. Should be a whale of a battle, Bill Watts.
That's certainly true, Boyd Pierce. Ernie Ladd's got a lot of things to pay back. He had his knee surgery because of this man. Battle of Giants, these guys, everything's out the window. You know, in collegiate wrestling next year, they're going to limit heavyweights to 350 pounds maximum. And each year for 3 years, that's going to come down. Well, the one-man gang would be over 100 pounds over that maximum right now. Ernie Ladd, 320. Great athlete, former All-Pro, just inducted the Hall of Fame at San Diego Chargers. But right now, he's not putting down skill. He's coming right from the heart. We're just trying to hurt somebody. Forearm. Another big forearm, the way he used to straighten up those offensive linemen. Big E, All-American at Grambling. Oh!
A lot of size. It's showing you just a tremendous power. One man gang going for it. I thought he had Big E down there again. Big E throwing a size 18 boot right into him, feeding him a shoe leather and firing away. Big E is wailing him down there. One man gang is getting it all. Big Ernie Ladd dishing out the punishment with a one-man gang. Scandal Akbar certainly can't be enjoying this. This is his protege. This is the man that he says is going to take the Louisiana title from the Junkyard Dog. Boyd Pierce, we just had a man run by in front of us. A huge man. Boyd Pierce, that's the Mongolian. Killer Khan, that's the man who injured Andre the Giant, and he just caught it. Ernie Ladd with a thrust kick, drove the big man clear over the top rope. Killer Khan, the Mongolian. Ernie Ladd went clear over that top rope. Albert Neely signified the disqualification. Boyd Pierce, the Mongolian, Killer Khan, a one-man gang. I don't think anybody can clean that ring out.
Well, Bill, watch while we try to restore some sort of order in our good taste and best interest of our fans. We go to a commercial break, and then we'll return.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 275 pounds from the Big Sky Country of Montana, the Hangman, Rick Harris. And in the blue corner at 222 pounds from Houston, Texas, Tony Torres.
Montana, the Big Sky Country, with his lariat and his noose, Hangman Rick Harris versus Tony Torres. There you have Rick Pereira in the center of the ring for the instructions. Calls for the bell. Bill Watts.
Boyd Pierce, this man appeared as a bounty hunter for Skandar Akbar trying to take the measure of Dick Murdoch. But all he got was that entrenching tool as the Murdoch smacked him one. But Rick Harris shows he's a pretty tough man, that he just said he's going to stick around and try somebody else. And he did manage to almost hang Dick Murdoch. During the commercial break, they helped Big Ernie Ladd, who was really caught by surprise. Skandar Akbar showing that he too learns from the moves other people pull, because it wasn't some short few months ago that Ernie Ladd had pulled the same similar surprise on Akbar by having the assassin standing by. And Akbar apparently has certainly not saved his purse strings in getting the Mongolian, the big Killer Khan, the man who hospitalized Andre the Giant, the only man to ever seriously injure the Giant. He broke Andre's ankle. So certainly he has a reputation, and it seems like Skandar Akbar it's a battle to the finish. It's almost like the British and the Falklands and the Israelis and the Palestine liberation. It's to the finish. It's ongoing. And there's casualties on each side, but the center, Skandar Akbar, and who's going to dominate the Mid-South area. And, of course, at the focal point, Akbar is definitely Ernie Ladd, and definitely, above it all, the Junkyard Dog. And Akbar has said that the one-man gang is going to wear the Louisiana heavyweight title that's currently around the waist of the Junkyard Dog. Rick Hangman Harris, who's his own man, but he is for hire. Of course, next will be King Cobra makes his return with Jesse Barr against the Assassin and Grappler. That should be a great tag team bout. Ooh, Tony Torres met a knee there with big Rick Hangman Harris. And I understand you're going to have the man who's creating so much of the controversy as your guest commentator next week, Boyd.
Exactly right, Bill Watts. That's the North American heavyweight champion, Bob Roop, will be here at our table.
Grizzly Smith informed us that there is going to be, that Ted DiBiase will get a one fall, no disqualification match against the North American champion. And he hopes to have that match within the time limit that DiBiase has imposed upon himself and upon Mid-South.
Not only will Bob Roop be our guest commentator, but next week, the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship on the line, the Junkyard Dog versus the Masked Grappler. So
Well, that should be a great one because the grappler has certainly been a champion. He's tasted that fine ambrosia of being on top, and he covets the dog's belt, as does everybody, and the grappler is a man to be reckoned with. Certainly as of late, it seems like the grappler's done some scheming with the assassin. Rick Harris, powerfully powering away. Dr. Death Steve Williams will be back on television next week, the young All-American from Oklahoma University. The sports writers all over the country are really following his rookie season in pro wrestling. The uniqueness of it all, this man will still be on Oklahoma University's fine football team next year with head coach Barry Sloan. Well, that's a reverse neck breaker by the Hangman. Oh, he snapped his neck there. Went up for a power slam and dropped him across the top cable. Those are steel cables inside that rubber insulation. And he flat put it to him. Hangman Rick Harris. He's got Tony Torres up, and I don't think Tony Torres can do much about the situation right now. And Ricky Ferrara is asking Tony Torres. I thought Tony submitted Ricky Ferrara. That's a potentially dangerous hold, and there Ricky Ferrara signals the end of the match by submission.
And we'll be back with tag team action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
It's tag team action now for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner, at a total combined weight of 500 pounds, the two masked men, the assassin, and his partner, the grappler. In the blue corner, at 235 pounds, from Chula, Mississippi, King Cobra. And his partner, at 236 pounds, from Portland, Oregon, Jesse Barr.
Introduction of the tag team match, the rugged team of the assassin and the grappler, both of them with their masks, versus the popular duo of Jesse Barr and King Cobra. Bill Watts now will tell us the description. This should be a really outstanding tag team event, Bill.
Certainly should, boy. These are four great athletes out there. Jesse Barr, the young rookie from Oregon. Ooh, he got sidestepped right then by the grappler. The grappler is a ring-wise veteran, and of course the man that's probably the best tag team wrestler in the world, the assassin. Man, asks no quarter and certainly gives none. King Cobra, it's great to see him back, a fine athlete from Tennessee. Well, actually, he's from Chula, Mississippi, excuse me. But he's a favorite. He's a great young athlete. Don't get to see him too often. We certainly miss him. Boy, Pierce, I'd like to maybe leave the desk with you here. And I'm still this Ernie Ladd, I don't believe, has ever been blindsided or as duped as bad as he was today. I mean, he's been in a lot of battles, a lot of great football games, and yet he just flat got clipped from behind with Akbar bringing in the Killer Khan. And I just wonder if maybe we can get some information on that. I'm going to leave the desk here before this is a time limit remaining match. And maybe I could get Ernie Ladd and see if he is just how bad he was hurt back there in the dressing room, and a chance to get him out here to answer some questions you may have.
Fine, Bill, and thank you for another great job as our guest commentator, Cowboy Bill Watts. As action continues in the ring, King Cobra tags in his partner, Jesse Barr. Barr with the arm of the masked assassin. Jesse Barr and the assassin in the center of the ring, the knee to the midsection by the masked assassin. As he twirls him over in the far corner, and the knee of the grappler between the top and second strand of rope catches him flush. Grappler now continues on Jesse Barr.
Boy, this is a great match, and we do have Ernie Ladd standing by. Hopefully we'll have time for you to talk to him or for me to talk to him. Fast moving match. These guys are all active. Great condition. T- Tag is made. King Cobra's taking it to the assassin. Got him in a predicament. Ralph Neely dove for the count, but the wily assassin managed to get out. One thing you have to watch with the, that didn't quite have the same effect it would always have. The assassin using that vicious headbutt, Cobra blocking it, showing that he can use his own head. You gotta watch the assassin and the grappler. They're smooth and the teamwork situation. They'll tag behind you when you don't see them, and they'll try to get a fresh man in you. They'll use subterfuge. These guys are wily veterans. That's the difference in the seasoning. Jesse Barr showing that he's got some real explosion, some firepower himself. How much time we have left, Boyd? About 2 minutes of television time left. Jesse Barr going, tag is made. The grappler tagged the assassin behind Jesse Barr. Never saw it coming. That's what that experience counts right there, and they've just racked up another victory. We're going to try to get Ernie Ladd out here, Boyd Pierce.
Boyd Pierce, let me tell you something. I have never been blindsided. I have never been blindsided like this. You know, watch, we've had our difference and everything else, but I've been blindsided like this, never like this in football before. I've had all type of injuries, but the thing about it, they didn't put me out. When you stay in shape, you're tough, and you're ready to come back, I'd like to get this man, Khan. Is it any way possible? I'd like to get Khan anywhere, anytime. I always get the man that get Ernie Ladd. Akbar pulled another trick of his, you know, but it's one thing about it. He didn't put me out.
Well, Ernie, it certainly shows that Akbar learns by other people's maneuvers, because a few short months ago, you had a man stashed and suckered in the Samoans and put him on the run. And so it seems like the Akbar, the one thing about him being so devious and having the money that he has, he can reach out and he's repaying you in kind, and he is a dangerous opponent.
Well, one thing I got to say, it's like a chess game. It's who got the most marks in the end. I don't plan to go down again. Akbar's a loudmouth. He's backed his stuff up. I'm a loudmouth. I'm backing mine up. All I can say, if I can get some of Akbar's people, because somebody's got to be hurt, somebody has to go to the hospital.
Ernie, we'll have to talk with matchmaker Grizzly Smith, like we've always said on Mid-South Wrestling. Our time is gone. A lot of exciting action. We'll have more next week. Remember the Louisiana heavyweight title on the line, the Junkyard Dog versus the Masked Grappler. Apparently in 2 weeks we'll have that match. Ted DiBiase versus Bob Roop, one fall, no disqualification. We'll talk to Bob Roop next week as he'll be our guest commentator. Till then, for our guest commentator this week, Cowboy Bill Watts, I'm Boyd Pierce, saying goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. Hello, everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm your host, I'm Boyd Pierce, and we have a lot of exciting action signed by matchmaker Grizzly Smith. The Louisiana Heavyweight Championship will be on the line as the Junkyard Dog defends his title against the challenge of the Masked Grappler. Also, Steve Dr. Death Williams, who gave two tremendous matches as he started his professional career right here on Mid-South Wrestling. He's be back. Ted DiBiase will be in action. The Big Cat Ernie Ladd. Lots of great wrestling matches coming up. Our guest commentator of the week is North American Heavyweight Champion Bob Roop. Bob, you're a man of great controversy. In fact, there's not one but two top men, and I reiterate, top men in the world that are after you and your North American Heavyweight title. That's in the form and fashion of the Junkyard Dog and Ted DiBiase.
Well, boy, that's true. You know, it's only fitting that the top people in the country and the world should be after me, because with this title, I am the number one heavyweight in the country. You know, I can handle the competition. I've always been able to. I'm the man with the plan. But I'd like to say this. You know, people have talked in the past about me being a controversial, saying I break the rules. I've noticed that Ted DiBiase recently is out here wearing his glove on his hand, saying something about his hand is hurt or something. Well, listen, I'm supposed to wrestle him next week. I'm going to wrestle him next week for this title. But before next week, I want that hand either x-rayed to make sure there's nothing in that glove, or I want that glove taken off there. And I mean, it's only fair. I'm not wearing any gloves or anything.
All right, we'll get your comments as we go along. Right now, the first match is in the ring. Let's go for the introduction and Reese Bout.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 245 pounds, from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond. And in the blue corner at 300 pounds from Lakewood, Colorado, Dr. Death, Steve Williams.
This event, one fall, 10-minute time limit in the black tights. Mike Bond against from the pride of the Big Red, Oklahoma University, four times NCAA wrestling champion, Dr. Death, Steve Williams.
Well, he is. He's got an international reputation, one of the best in this country, of course, for the last 4 years. Nice switch, inside switch. As you can see, Mike Bond knows a little. Ooh, look at the power of that Dr. Death Steve Williams. Of course, you know, if I had a chance to get in there with Steve Williams, even though he seems to be a very powerful young man, I'd probably just tie him up and slap him around a little bit. But Mid-South seems to be protecting him. Mike Bond makes a nice go behind. Of course, the doctor, he left that leg open. This Williams, Dr. Death, going behind the man. Now, you see he's a little tentative there, and that's just a lack of experience. That's why a man, a veteran like myself, would be able to handle him fairly easily. Again, power, he's got a lot of power on his head.
But Bob, with the power, as you see there in Dr. Death, Steve Williams, he doesn't need any organization or anybody to protect him, the way I look at it.
Well, that's a matter of speaking. Nice arm drag there. He does know some professional, you know, that's a variation of an amateur move, so I'm not surprised that he knows that move. It's done a little bit differently in the pro. But, again, I issued a challenge some time ago to Dr. Death, and all those little guys playing for Barry Switzer, all his teammates, I know they heard it, and I can't get his name on the dotted line. Like I say, Mid-South is smart in protecting him against somebody like me. Now, he's showing a little temper there. Mike Bond just had to give him a little shove there to get that temper flowing. Well, oh, he kicked him, left himself wide open, punch. Now again, this man has a great background, but he's showing a little inexperience here. Mike Bond caught him with a beautiful crossbody. Ooh, look at that power. It looked like he had a three count almost, but he apparently was just. Now, again, he's showing amateur style here, sort of waiting to see what his opponent's going to do. Well, he's stunned, too. But this big, strong man, wow, look at that. He reversed him there. Now, he is just, he's got the attitude, I think, that he can take everything and anybody can give out. Of course, against a Mike Bond,
that's
okay.
One of the reasons he's four times All-American.
Well, he's one of the greatest amateurs in the last five, 6 years in this country. He's showing why. Now that football tackle, ooh, went right out from under him, dropped Mike Bond across his neck and shoulders, whoops him into that far turnbuckle. Ooh. Ooh. Very impressive.
1, 2, 3. Steve Dr. Death Williams, hand raised in victory as he goes on the streak, continues. We'll be back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
No, you're one of the best at your profession. I want to show I'm the best at mine in terms of brains. A while back, I carried Paul Orndorff for a while, and I was letting him use my brains with his muscles. And I found out he was just selfish and egotistical and thought only of himself. And I thought, why should I let him use my brains? I went ahead and made a fool out of Paul Orndorff, and then I went ahead and beat him and chased him off. So I know how to make people pack their bags. And I'm only saying this, not bragging. Only saying this because of the fact I finally got Ted DiBiase where I want him. He has said he'll pack his bags. I didn't even have to say it.
All right, Bob. And on March the 17th, a match between Ted DiBiase and Bob Roop for the North American Heavyweight title. Let's watch it right now.
The thing that impresses me a lot about Bob Roop is that he's always thinking. He's a very strict tactician in the ring, much like a very intelligent coach like Tom Landry, the Dallas Cowboys. His game plan is always set before he gets in the ring. He's a very intelligent man. There, he looks like he's going for the shoulder breaker, but DiBiase has got some plans of his own. Great power slam. DiBiase with a power
Hang
slam.
Hang on, if he lock it in.
If he locks it in, boy, it may be all over right here. Let's watch if he can escape. He's the man that patented the escape. Let's see how it works out.
There he comes, giving it all he's got.
Roop's trying to reverse the leverage. Roop has reversed the leverage, and now the leverage is on the leg of Ted DiBiase. DiBiase's face, I noticed in the monitor, look at the contortion of DiBiase's face. He is at the hands of Roop now with his figure four. DiBiase has got to get back on his back. He has got to get back on his back to gain the advantage.
And the challenger all the time applying that much-needed pressure.
Both these men are in tremendous physical condition, but Ted DiBiase, to get the advantage, to become the aggressor again, has got to turn him over, and there he does. Now DiBiase's got the advantage. Roop goes to the ropes. Now the referee has got to break the hold, which he does. The referee, Alfred Neely, doing a fine job breaking the hold.
Bob Roop done a fine job of saving that match when he grabbed that steel cable on the bottom strand to cause it to be broken. And there you're seeing Alfred Neely slammed outside the ring on the cement floor.
The referee has hit the concrete floor. The referee has hit the concrete floor, and DiBiase has taken a lot of punishment on that leg.
As a one-man gang, Jim, on a backboard who's giving the directions.
454 pounds, Boyd. He is really wrenching that leg. Look at DiBiase's face.
That is a steel ring post. You've seen him wrapping it around.
He's trying to break DiBiase's leg. All 454
pounds. On the far side, he's still out. Alfred Neely, the referee, unable to see anything, being thrown out on the far side. Now you're seeing Roop now, as he himself goes for the finishing hold. If he can hold it, the injured Ted DiBiase really being worked over by the one-man gang.
Roop looks very confident at this point. DiBiase has sustained an unbelievable amount of pressure from General Skandar Akbar's one-man gang. DiBiase, you can hear him, Boyd, all the way over here. He's yelling in pain. This match, it's on the line right here for Ted DiBiase. It's on the line right here. And Roop has got the hold of the figure four locked in. DiBiase may be unconscious. DiBiase's out.
Alfred Neely called for the bell.
The referee has stopped the match. Boyd, it looks like this could be a very unique situation. The referee has stopped the match.
Gets the bell. What did he do with it?
The referee's decision goes to Bob Roop. The referee's decision stopping the match to hopefully prevent permanent injury to Ted DiBiase. And right here on Mid-South, Boyd, we've got a new Mid-South, new North American champion.
That's right, and everybody but the referee saw what happened. The big man, the one-man gang, under the direction of Skandar Akbar, is responsible.
Boyd, I never admitted before, but that picture, I guess I have to say that, that was really a dirty, nasty thing to do, but it worked, and I can say it now because there's nothing Mid-South can do about it. They can't take that title back. They can't give Ted DiBiase that 6 weeks he spent on his back. They can't give that back to him. So I can admit it now. Yeah, I did it.
All
I
right,
am
now,
the champion.
Now let's hear what Ted DiBiase had to say.
First of all, ladies and gentlemen, I don't want any of you wrestling fans out there to feel that Ted DiBiase has gotten too big for his britches or that I'm off on a big ego trip. It's just that I was unjustly robbed of the North American heavyweight title, and up until now I have not been given proper opportunity to regain that title. And I want to go on record as thanking Mid-South Wrestling right now for going ahead and giving me the opportunity that I want and I deserve to regain the North American title right here next week on television. I got a one-fall, no disqualification match with you, Bob Roop, for the North American heavyweight title. And Roop, if you can come out here next week and beat me in a no disqualification match without any other help from outside, no, I take that back, Roop. If I can't beat you in this match, I will pack my bag, and I will leave Mid-South without any hard feelings because I've asked for this match, and they've given me the opportunity. And about this hand, Roop, you're complaining about the hand. Well, you know why the hand is hurt. The hand is hurt because of you, and it is simply taped. There's a handball glove covering it to hold the tape on when it gets sweaty. And I would never, Roop, as you would insinuate, use this glove to cheat and use it for an unfair advantage over anybody, because I'm not like you. So right here, Roop, next week, we're going to settle this thing once and for all.
Bob Roop, in the past in title matches or just in any kind of wrestling match, you've been known to connive and do different things that maybe a lot of people don't agree with, but this match has been signed for the North American heavyweight title with no disqualification against you or whoever happens to be the North American heavyweight champion in case you come up with another one of your super podges, and if he wins, he will be the North American heavyweight champion.
Well, Boyd, I used a subterfuge once. That was just to get this title because I needed to make my break. Since then, I've beaten everybody that came up against me. Like I said, I chased off Paul Orndorff, Ted DiBiase spent 6 weeks regretting the fact that I beat him for this belt. So, I mean, that's no problem. I'll be there, and, I mean, I'm going to send Ted DiBiase packing.
I still say you use super fudge. That's the word I like to use. Ted DiBiase is in the ring. Let's go for the introduction of the match.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 235 pounds from Charlotte, North Carolina, Billy the Star Child Star. And in the blue corner at 255 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, former North American heavyweight champion Ted DiBiase.
Billy Starr been introduced, and across the ring, the man that you listen to and the man Bob Roop's been talking about, Ted DiBiase, Alfred Neely, called for the bell. Now here's Bob.
Well, you know, Ted DiBiase, of course, it wasn't any slouch, as you can see by the fact that he is very athletic. Two-time North American champion, 1979 and again 1981 and 82. He started here as a pro, was 1975 Rookie of the Year, West Texas State three-time letterman football player. Oh, he's a great athlete. It wasn't any slouch that I beat and put out for 6 weeks. You can see him moving around there, agility, using his head. Oh, drop kick caught Billy Starr right in the face. That's Billy Starr's moving around pretty good himself. I don't know too much about him, except he's a veteran. He is trying to make a name for himself because he's going up against one of the best. But I also know Ted DiBiase would sell his mother's china to get this North American title. Slams Billy Starr. See, I know Ted DiBiase thinks about me every morning when he shaves, when he looks at his wife, whatever he's doing, he thinks about me. Nice fireman's carry there.
Another thing Ted DiBiase said, it'd be no disqualification, and he will be using that hand that you've spoken of before.
Well, again, now that glove is going to have to go. I don't know what people complain about me breaking rules or whatever, and he's out there saying his hand is hurt. If his hand was hurt, how could he wrestle? He says it's a protective device of some kind. I want that thing checked or removed before next week. Look at him here now. He's using chops, and I believe he was chopping with the so-called injured hand. Again, I'm sure he's thinking of me when he's beating up on this guy. Another drop kick. He's getting high with that drop kick. He's catching the guy around the chin, the neck area. Power slam. Okay, he's good. He's not as good as I am. He's very good.
And the winner from Omaha, Nebraska, Ted DiBiase.
That glove has got to go.
We'll return right after this work with more action right here on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 300 pounds from Mongolia, General Skandor Akbar proudly presents Killer Khan. And in the blue corner at 237 pounds from Chula, Mississippi, King Cobra.
Action continues with the introduction of Killer Khan, now under the stable and banner of General Skandor Akbar. We saw Killer Khan made his unmentionable and undisclosed appearance last week, the top star from Mongolia, the only man ever in professional wrestling to injure Andre the Giant, in against the very popular and capable star from Chula, Mississippi, King Cobra.
Well, a truly international flavor to this match. Look at the strength of this man. He's using a variation of some kind of I don't know if that's martial arts. I know Mongolia is very, very, very strong with amateur wrestling. I was very impressed with them at the Olympics. And he took King Cobra down with a power move, not choking. Now he's gone to the basics. He is stunning his man. You got to hand it to the general. He comes up with top people. And he had a surprise, you might say, last week for Ernie Ladd and some people.
But Bob Roop coming up next, the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship, the Junkyard Dog defending against the Masked Grappler.
Well, that should be very, very interesting. The Grappler's got a great background. Everybody knows the Junkyard Dog. But back to this Killer Khan here. Now, this man is putting some intense pressure on a fine competitor. I've wrestled against King Cobra myself, and he's tough. Anybody grows up and makes it up out of Chula, Mississippi, fine athlete, is a tough, tough man. And he is tough. And this man is handling him so far. He has just dominated him. Very impressive. I don't think the general is going to spend his money foolishly. He knows what he's buying. He doesn't buy a pig in a poke. He's got himself one here. Man, he's very impressive. He's intimidating with that look, with the look of him. He looks like a killer. And so far, he's given every indication that he is very, very serious about not just winning matches, about doing what the general wants him to do, and that's to hurt some people. Again, he's staying on him now. He's got the man's arm injured.
Akbar on the outside giving him plenty of vocal assistance.
Beautiful big high backbreaker. Okay. He's rounding out his attack. He started with an arm. Now he's working the back. And on the back. You injure too many points in a man's body, he can't stand up. He doesn't have any. It's like a table with no legs. Well, he's going to pound the middle right out of that table. It's not fancy, but it's effective. And you got to remember, it's not how you win, it's whether you win or not in professional sports. Now, he's got a five count, and he broke there on about 3.5, which is perfectly legal. Maybe people don't approve of it, but it's perfectly legal. Now, again, King Cobra fighting fire with fire. All he's done this match so far is throw two punches, and he is a tremendous competitor. I'm surprised at the ease that this man is handling him. Well, I'm not really surprised. This Killer Khan has a reputation. That's why Skandar Akbar, I imagine, he couldn't tell anybody this guy was coming. If he did, who knows? Ernie Ladd might have, I don't want to say anything like that, but why warn somebody?
Sometimes he connives along like somebody like Bob Roop. A lot of times he doesn't disclose everything that he's going to do.
Well, if you're playing poker, you don't tell people what your hole card is, that's for sure. Now King Cobra, and look, Killer Khan appeared to get irritated there at getting smacked in the face a couple times. This man can take it as well as give it out. Well, he made a mistake there. He got caught. Drop kick. Well, he finally got him off his feet.
What has surprised him, Bob Roop, is King Cobra is one of the finest young grapplers in professional wrestling.
He made a mistake there. He went to the man's power. He went to his upper body. He tried to head scissors him. He didn't have the man beaten down enough yet. He got caught. The Killer Khan dropped him across the top rope. He's going for a leg sweep. Power sweep, your top back of your head hits all the way down to the base of your spine. Going on that second rope. This man weighs 300 pounds. Look at him, he's up there like a butterfly. Ooh, ooh, devastation. That is all she wrote.
All she wrote's right. No man can stand under that power as Killer Khan has his hand raised by the referee and his manager, Skandar Akbar. We'll be back. The Luzanne Heavyweight Championship on the line. Junkyard Dog versus the Grappler after this message from Mid-South Wrestling.
And now a title match for the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship. This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 246 pounds, former North American Heavyweight Champion, the Grappler. And at 265 pounds from Tennessee, the Louisiana Heavyweight Champion, the Junkyard Dog.
This is the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship match sanctioned by Mid-South Wrestling. Right here on television, the champion, the Junkyard Dog, as referee Alfred Neely displaying it to the fans here, and the challenge of the Masked Grappler. This is a one fall with TV time remaining, as matchmaker Grizzly Smith giving the participants plenty of time for a championship match. If it doesn't go the full time limit, we have time left. Standby matches have been signed. Jesse Barr versus Hangman Rick Harris. The Big Cat Ernie Ladd versus Randy Bass. Tag team action, Tony Torres and Mike Hudspeth against the one-man gang and the Assassin. All coming up if we have any time left over. Bob Roop?
Boy, the physique and the strength of the Junkyard Dog are truly phenomenal. I felt it myself. The man has developed some serious strength. I mean, almost to the point of being overpowered. He picked up the grappler there and threw him around like a sack of potatoes. And the grappler's no slouch. He wouldn't get this match if he didn't have the credentials. He's one half, he was twice Mississippi State champion, one half the Mid-South Tag Champion, and for a year and a half, the North American champion. So he's one of the men that made this belt great that I'm holding today. Junkyard Dog, look at the agility. Ooh! Grappler either made a mistake or Junkyard Dog took advantage of it. Ooh, he's showing, ooh! He is coming at him every way but loose. Shoulder tackles, clothesline. Now the grappler's showing some serious, he's a heady wrestler. He's one of the few wrestlers in the country that will wrestle with a handicap like he has today. But he got out of the ring there, which in some cases, it's in warfare, it's good to withdraw and regroup at times. And that's exactly what he was doing there, because Junkyard Dog just about took his head off with that 22-inch arm. And I'm talking about his forearm.
Tremendous athlete in the form of the Junkyard Dog. And you not only have to deal with Ted DiBiase, but also this same athlete, the Louisiana champion, Junkyard Dog, Bob.
Well, that's true. Now, he can be taken off his feet. Grappler knows how to apply those. Ooh, maybe he was just setting him up for that one. Ooh, right hand. Very unorthodox attack. Two non-wrestling moves and a wrestling move. Back on his feet like a cat. Ooh, that elbow. But see, the grappler is taking it. He's not knocked out, and he is, I'm sure he's hurt. I'm sure he's stunned. I'm sure he's wondering what's happening right now, but he is not out. And that's the reason that he is, Mid-South does not give title matches to just anybody. And if you want to talk about Ted DiBiase, that's all right, because there's only another week to talk about him. Anyway, ooh, the grappler made a mistake there. And he made another mistake. Getting out of the ring wasn't enough in this case.
Well, he couldn't clear the ring. Is that way he couldn't get away from the grasp of the Junkyard Dog?
Well, the Junkyard Dog is smart there. Now, he made a mistake. And the grappler will definitely take advantage of any mistakes anybody makes, just like I do. Junkyard Dog's showing his strength, his resilience there. But he is definitely slowed down. Backbreaker. That hurts. Kidneys. Knocks the wind out of you. Now, the grappler is putting the pressure on. That is the thing to do in this case. When you get the Junkyard Dog at any kind of a disadvantage, you better take it. Ooh! Beautiful, beautiful. Full suplex. Oh! Well, I said the Junkyard Dog is a strong man. It takes strength to come out of that. The grappler knows how to apply that. Oh! Now he's going to. Now he's taking advantage. Now he's using his head to mobilize the man, get those 22-inch arms. Well, he didn't get him tied in. That's what he needed to do. Leg sweep. Junkyard Dog able to come back almost at will sometimes. Remarkable.
Ooh. The referee catched it. Alfred Needed caught it full. And yep. The grappler, there on the other side, and in the ring, the only man is the champion, the Junkyard Dog.
Well, now the grappler, the grappler's getting ready to go back in the ring.
Alfred Neely on the cement floor, but it's not the grappler.
Grappler's getting back.
It's the masked assassin, the Junkyard Dog. I don't know whether he realizes that it might still be the grappler because he just pulled him in from the apron.
The grappler, the assassin, he missed the kick.
Oh!
Junkyard Dog.
The assassin loaded up that forehead there, and now then, the Junkyard Dog, he realizes that it is not the grappler, Bob Roop.
Well, it's impossible. It's kind of hard to tell from here. Whoever that was went out. That's the grappler. There's the grappler. Yeah, he was there the whole time.
Now power the grappler's slam. Back in the ring. Alfred Neely out. That is a junk.
One-man gang.
The one-man gang entering.
I know what he's going to do. He's going to break his leg. He's going to wrap that leg around the post.
Alfred Neely called for the bell, and the one-man gang on the leg of Junkyard Dog, you recall 2 weeks
Look
ago
Look at
here.
Ted DiBiase running in that match in the
Ted DiBiase. For the rest of you, remember 2 weeks ago, the one-man gang grabbed Ted DiBiase and threw his leg against that steel post. That is your decision. Alfred Neely disqualifies for outside interference and still Louisiana heavyweight champion, the Junkyard Dog.
Ted DiBiase should be suspended for interference.
We still have
like
some
that.
Time left, so we'll have more standby matches coming up after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner, at 275 pounds from the Big Sky Country of Montana, Rick the Hangman Harris. And in the blue corner at 236 pounds from Portland, Oregon, Jesse Barr.
Louisiana championship match over. That means all of the following matches will be standby matches as long as we have time. This match is Jesse Barr versus the Hangman Rick Harris. Following next match will be the Big Cat Ernie Ladd versus Randy Bays. And another standby match if time lingers will be Tony Torres and Mike Hudspeth against the rugged duo of the Big One-Man Gang and the Masked Assassin. Right now, Hangman Harris versus Jesse Barr. Here's Bob.
Some very disparate styles in the ring right now, Boyd. Hangman Harris, not much of like an amateur technician, more of a rough and ready, uses his weight well, as you see there. Coming off the ropes, Jesse Barr, nice move. He almost got caught. Nice arm drag, Jesse Barr, of course, 15 years amateur, 1977 junior world champion. His background speaks for itself. Fine, fine background. All he's lacking is a little experience as a pro. Hangman Harris, I don't know a whole lot about him. I've heard his name spoken of in a lot of different places around the world. Hey. That looked like sort of a standoff there. Again, he's going right to basics now, using that Jesse Barr, using his weight. But it looks like he was stunned by those forearms, or the weight advantage took its effect there, because he ran into Hangman Harris, and he's the one that had the momentum, and still he's the one that ricocheted right off him. Now, this kind of move, of course, well, you can see he's not on the man's throat. It's a legal move, illegal, not illegal. It's a legal move. At the same time, though, it puts a lot of pressure up around the central nervous system. The base, of course, is the brain. And quite frankly, I never let anybody hold me in this kind of hole, because it
Bob Roop, you didn't pick up too much on the previous match for the Louisiana title when Alfred Neely, the referee, was out on the cement floor. Likewise was the Grappler, which was the challenger. You didn't say too much when the assassin came in and jumped in the ring, started on the champion, the Junkyard Dog, loaded up his hood, and then finally the Junkyard Dog realized who it was. Then here come the One-Man Gang came in and tried to work his leg over, just like he did Ted DiBiase 2 weeks ago, and DiBiase came to the ring. You didn't say too much about it.
Well, you know, Boyd, you were kind of handling it, and I didn't quite see it that way. I couldn't see it that clearly on the monitor. Now, Hangman Harris has taken over here, but I did see Ted DiBiase run out there, which he's only got one more week to do, by the way, and interfere in somebody else's match, and he's going to get himself hurt real bad one of these days doing that. Of course, it's going to have to be somewhere else, because I'm going to pack his bags for him here. But Hangman Harris has obviously the rough-and-ready style and that weight advantage seem to be taking its toll here. I was going to say I didn't know too much about him, Boyd, but I saw him hang up somebody the caliber of Dick Murdoch, so he's not any slouch, because Dick Murdoch does not get hung up by just anybody.
Captain Redneck, Dick Murdoch still on the international tour of the Orient and the Far East. Well, Australia.
He's doing it with a red
New
neck.
New Zealand, Australia, out, back, down under.
Ooh. Well, I'm sure that he needs a rest. Well, I don't want to say that, but the Mid-South has the best wrestlers in the world. They really come here from all those places to make their reputation, because in the United States, let's face it, it's number one country. And if you're number one in Mid-South, then you're number one in the country, in the world for that matter. Now, Jesse Barr has finally gotten hot here or something. He's giving him back a little bit. Goes for a head scissors, gets it. Nice balance, nice agility. Now he made a mistake. He stepped right out in front of him and tried to get a hold, and Harris just unloaded on him. He should have tried to get behind him and do something really, something to finish him. Okay, ran under. Nice move. Ooh, he went for the victory roll, and Harris had his balance the right way, the strength, whatever, to resist that thing, and dropped him right across his throat. And he goes for the neck breaker. And Jesse Barr is not going to come out of this one.
Hangman Rick Harris over Jesse Barr. You saw Jesse's, as he made the move, his neck went across that steel cable on the second strand of rope. A victory for Hangman Harris. Ernie Ladd versus Randy Bass when we return after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 240 pounds from Fort Worth, Texas, Randy Bass.
Randy Bass in the ring. His opponent, the big cat Ernie Ladd.
Where is Ernie Ladd?
And right now we're waiting for big Ernie Ladd to come to the arena, but I see referee Alfred Neely is running to the ring. Let's see what's going on here.
Richard, there's been a problem here. Ernie Ladd had refused to wrestle in this match, so Grizzly Smith had got a substitute, be Jesse Barr.
Okay, there you have it. For some reason, Ernie Ladd has refused to wrestle in this match, so across the ring in the blue corner, at 236 pounds from Portland, Oregon, Jesse Barr.
Well, Bob Roop, you heard the introduction, same as I did, as Alfred Neely came to the ring late and told Richard Bowden that Ernie Ladd refused to participate in this match against Randy Bass. Jesse Barr coming back doing yeoman duty, and that's a compliment to this youngster from Portland, Oregon. So what happened to Ernie Ladd and why he refused? He must have his reason, as you do sometimes.
Well, obviously, Jesse Barr's got more guts in his kneecap than Ernie Ladd's got in his whole body, because where's Ladd? I mean, he got a chance to come out here and continue down the comeback trail. Jesse Barr just got dropped on his gizzard a few minutes ago, and he's out here now. He obviously has got a lot of stamina and some recuperatory power, because he is out and he is carrying, he's carrying it too, Randy Bass. But again, Ernie Ladd, this is refusing to wrestle. Well, you never heard me refuse to wrestle. I wrestle anybody, anywhere, anytime. And, you know, because I had a background like young Jesse Barr, for example, 15 years of amateur and beating everybody in the Olympics and gold medals and that kind of stuff. So I'm used to this kind of stuff. Now, he made a mistake there. He gave him too much time, and he didn't have him beaten down enough. Randy Bass came off with a knee to the side of the head, which is smart. Because Jesse Barr had that neck injured early, and if I was wrestling, that's what I'd go after. And looks like now Randy Bass is giving him too much time. Stay on. If you're going to beat somebody, stay on him. When you got him down, I mean, if you're at football, you make a block. You got to continue all the way through with it. Tennis, you got to stroke. You got to continue all the way through with it. Ooh. Looked like he caught him either in the throat, which would be illegal. The forehead, whatever. Randy Bass seems to be on Dream Street, and goes for a body slam there. He doesn't have him down yet. Goes for a wrap up there. He still doesn't have him down enough to keep those shoulders down. He's gonna have to hit him with something else here. Ooh, oh, that was beautiful. That was absolutely beautiful.
And it resulted in a victory. Jesse Barr coming back from defeat, substituted for Ernie Ladd, even the score by gaining a victory. We still have time left, so we'll have tag team action coming up after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
And now it's tag team action for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 454 pounds, General Skandor Akbar presents the one-man gang. And his partner at 255 pounds, the Assassin. We're waiting now for the opponents to enter the arena. Well, it seems that the opponents are having a little difficulty getting into the arena.
Hey, you heard Richard Bowden, Bob Roop. One-man gang and Assassin in the ring. Their opponents, Tony Torres and Mike Hudspeth, yet to make an appearance.
Well, they might have had second thoughts, Boyd. I wouldn't blame them.
Bring them out.
The General has got a really kind of a formidable team here. Assassin's one of the best in the world. One-man gang has put out about six or seven wrestlers since he's been in the Mid-South. So, I mean, maybe Tony Torres and Mike Hudspeth figure the price is too high to wrestle these men. The General certainly has gotten some results, so spending his money wisely, you might say. And this new Killer Khan, he is very, very impressive.
As we said earlier, Killer Khan from Mongolia, the only man ever to injure the big eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant.
Well, you notice that people all have a theme in common. They injure people. Khan injured Andre the Giant. One-man gang injured a bunch of people.
Well, I don't see the scheduled opponents coming to the ring, but I do see someone moving into the arena.
Wait a minute. What is this? No, sir. We didn't sign pretty much with... Hey, that's Junkyard Dog. Johnny Ladd. No way.
And coming to the ring right now are two surprises, actually.
Bob Roop. There's Ernie Ladd and a Junkyard Dog.
I don't know what's going on here.
At 327 pounds from Houston, Texas, big Ernie Ladd and his partner, the Junkyard Dog.
It seems that they have
no opponents. The one-man gang and Skandar Akbar have deserted the ring.
Well, I don't blame them. They didn't sign a contract against these guys.
Obviously, they have deserted the ring, so that would apparently mean a forfeiture of the match.
Racer, all I can say is this. It's just about time that somebody take this thing under control.
Well, it seems that you and Big Ernie Ladd have certainly taken it under control.
Well, I owe a man a favor, Racer. When I owe a man a favor, I pay my debts. And it's time now for some United to come together. And Ladd, I owe you a favor, and I'm about to pay it. One time, baby. One time.
There, you've seen something that you never expected to see. Big Ernie Ladd and Junkyard Dog on the same team.
I heard Richard Bowden say that, but boy, that's very hard to believe that someone would stoop so low as to do that kind of thing, get rid of the regular opponent some way, and come out here and try to take over a match that they weren't even scheduled in. And I don't approve of that kind of thing.
Bob Roop, I always said it like it is here on Mid-South Wrestling, and it looks to me like the time has come when the Junkyard Dog and Ernie Ladd will have to let their personal differences, their animosities go by as being something behind them, join forces. Somebody has to stop the ruffians from General Skandar Akbar's army.
Well, the reason why is probably because if the Junkyard Dog is after me, it needs some help. But you people out there, I want to say, you got 1 week to wish Ted DiBiase goodbye. In fact, Boyd, I'd like to buy some time on this program next week. So after I beat Ted DiBiase, I would like to have his bags out here where everybody across the country could watch him pack his bags and head back to oblivion where he belongs.
We've had a lot of exciting action, a lot of confusion, a lot of great wrestling this week. Next week, one fall, no disqualification, Ted DiBiase gets a chance at the North American Heavyweight Championship match and the belt that goes with it. So until then, thank you so much for joining us week after week for our guest commentator, Bob Roop. I'm Boyd Pearson. Goodbye, everybody, for Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.